There's a very good study in Science, which was just published today, which talks about how people who are poorer are more likely to feel the impact. In fact, they said 1.5 to 3 times more likely to have anxiety and depression. And as you know, in India, we've had, you know, the whole migrant crisis and people have lost jobs and they're really vulnerable to mental health issues. So what can be done about that? How can we identify problems there? A lot of them haven't got their jobs back. A lot of them are still out of work. So what can really the government do on scale, at scale, at the public health level to support them?
Yes.
This article also offers some solutions, right?
Correct. You know, and I kind of mentored that article in Science that was published today, and I'm thank you for mentioning it. So I think what the key thing what the article does is this. You know, for a long time, people have observed an association between living in poverty and poor mental health, particularly depression and anxiety. What the article has done is reviewed evidence that points to causal mechanisms using randomized controlled trials, demonstrating the mechanism through which both poverty leads to depression and anxiety, as well as vice versa. And so in doing so, we can see two different kinds of interventions that can help us break this vicious cycle. First, structural interventions that help reduce the impact of acute impoverishment, for example, on migrant workers. A good example of that would have been unconditional cash transfers, direct income support to those who have lost their employment, particularly the daily wage laborers of India, who constitute the majority of our workforce. But second, also recognizing that when you develop a mental health problem like depression and anxiety, providing low intensity psychological interventions can actually enable you to recover quickly, to regain hope, to regain the cognitive capabilities to get back into the workforce. So you need to do both structural interventions as well as health interventions. And as you probably know, some of the work that I've been doing with Sangat, the NGO in India, has really been focusing on the latter.
But do you think we have enough skilled health workers who can identify problems early and offer that kind of counseling and support? Because as you know, I mean, there are more psychiatrists of Indian origin in the US than there are in India. So do we really have the capacity to offer that kind of support to millions of people who need it?
So this is a huge question, a huge barrier. You know, do we have enough mental health professionals in India? Well, we don't. Not only do we not have enough in number, but they're also very, very unevenly distributed. So they're mostly working in urban areas and in the private sector. But there's a flip question, which is, do you need mental health professionals to actually deliver all kinds of mental health care? And the answer is we don't. After more than a decade and a half of systematic work by Indian organizations and organizations in other parts of the developing world, we now know that with carefully designed training programs, frontline workers like an ASHAs, like an Anganwadi workers, can deliver very effective psychological and social interventions for a whole range of mental health problems. And today we are working with governments like in Madhya Pradesh to actually scale up, for example, a brief psychological treatment for depression by using digital technologies to help ASHAs learn how to deliver these treatments and then to actually master the delivery of the treatment through peer supervision. So Sanchita, I see the future in that direction. How can we scale up rapidly these brief evidence-based psychological interventions through our existing community workforce, not just the ASHAs, but also, for example, the community health officers in the health and wellness centers, Anganwadi workers, and a range of other providers?